Balding is a deeply personal and emotional process that 85% of men around the world will experience at some point in their lives. 70% of men will have experienced hair loss by the age of 35. Male pattern baldness accounts for 95% of cases worldwide and is the most common form of hair loss. The stages of male pattern baldness are noticeable and predictable. It starts with hair loss at the temples and thinning hairs at the crown. Over time, these two areas form a receding M-shaped hairline. An O-shaped bald spot at the back of the head will then follow, and together, both areas will combine into a U-shaped horseshoe balding pattern. Like Thanos, male pattern baldness is inevitable. It's a genetic condition that's passed down and typically emerges between the ages of 25 and 35. For some men, male pattern baldness starts as early as their late teens. For me, I started balding in my early 20s, and it sucked. It felt bad to see my hairline recede every day in the mirror, to shed every time I washed my hair, to feel the hair at the crown of my head become thinner and fewer, to fight against the wind from exposing my temples around coworkers, and to hide my progressively large forehead in social outings. In my early 20s, I'd visit barber after barber before realizing that it wasn't their lack of skill, but instead the fact that I was balding that made it so difficult to style. I could only ever pull off one type of haircut, a taper comb-over that pulled hair from the sides to cover my temples and receding hairline. But no matter how hard I tried to downplay or hide my hair loss, I always felt and looked much older than I really was. The Hamilton-Norwood scale is a measurement system used by doctors to classify the stages of male pattern baldness. In my early 20s, I was at a stage 2. After college, I did no favors to my hairline as a new grad, working late nights and weekends at the office to climb up the corporate ladder. By my mid-20s, I had reached stage 3. Now in my late 20s and approaching stage 4, I was confronted with three options. One, I could do nothing, I could see balding as a way of life and learn to live with hair loss. Two, I could actively embrace the inevitable, proactively shave my head, and go bald by choice. Or three, I could fight back and restore my hair loss through prosthesis, medication, and or surgery, just like Elon Musk, Gordon Ramsay, Wayne Rooney, Tom Hanks, Nicolas Cage, Ben Affleck, Drew Brees, and Antonio Conte. With so many possible treatments with different degrees of effectiveness and cost, hair loss is a global billion-dollar market with ties not just into big pharmaceuticals, but also the medical tourism of developed countries like Turkey and South Korea. While we typically take a sideline analyst perspective on this channel, the reality is that there's only so much one can learn through financials and headlines. The best way to truly understand a business is to experience it yourself, and as someone who started balding in their early 20s, there's no better candidate to be a test subject, patient, and consumer of the hair loss industry than me. In this episode, we'll navigate the business of balding, the different treatments available, and the companies behind those solutions, all through my own personal experience and transformation from medication to hair transplant at a prestigious clinic in South Korea. When it comes to balding, the easiest treatment is prosthesis. Wigs and hairpieces are non-invasive, low-risk solutions. Toupees are the most popular choice of prosthesis for male pattern baldness. While wigs cover the entirety of one's head, toupees are customized hairpieces that cover only the specific areas of hair loss. With wigs, you can buy and wear one off the shelf, but toupees by design must be fitted properly to match your scalp, forehead, and hair. A toupee can cost from $20 to thousands of dollars, and the more convincing and natural a toupee looks, the more expensive it will be. The global hair prosthesis industry is a low-value $6 billion market. China is the world's largest producer, supplying 70% of the world's wigs, hair pieces, hair extensions, and toupees. Hunan Rebecca is the largest producer of wigs and toupees in the world and was the first ever hair prosthesis company to go public on the Shanghai Stock Exchange in 2003. Hunan Rebecca is a timely demonstration of the unsustainable expansion and radical diversification that's so popular with today's Chinese companies. In less than two decades, the company has gone from manufacturing wigs and toupees to also somehow managing four-star hotels, developing high-rises, buying an entire mountain and converting it into a tourist destination, operating luxury resorts, managing private high schools, mining gold in Africa, running amusement parks, supplying water to municipalities, processing sewage, and providing public transportation. With so many different businesses wrapped into one company, Hunan Rebecca's finances don't provide a clean look into the business of hair prosthesis. Common sense would indicate that such a massive business expansion could not have been funded from just selling wigs and hair pieces in the first place. A cleaner example would be the Hong Kong-based Evergreen Products, which is the fifth largest producer of hair prosthesis in the world. The company has three business lines: wigs and toupees, hair extensions, and Halloween costumes. If you ever wondered where those crappy costumes at Spirit with the outdated branding and models come from, it likely came from Evergreen. The US alone accounts for 90% of Evergreen's annual revenue, while wigs and toupees contribute 85% of the company's overall top line. While Evergreen's wig business has grown over the years with decent 20% gross margins, toupees make up an insignificantly small slice of the pie. Evergreen's go-to-market strategy has remained consistent in the past decade in targeting women, particularly African-American women, through wholesale to retailers and salons. In the past 5 years, male consumers and toupees have never once been mentioned in any company strategy, presentation, or report. While social acceptance has improved, toupees remain unpopular and niche for balding men. While production is concentrated in a few overseas suppliers like Evergreen, the actual salons and retailers who fit and sell toupees to end users are mostly local small businesses. These independent stylists and mom and pops are the ones who bear the cost of marketing, customizing, fitting, educating, and evangelizing toupees to male customers. Toupees are a difficult product where procurement requires personalization and trust. Sellers have to build trust, address the psychological barriers and cost concerns, and customize toupees with customers one at a time in order to close a sale. While I could order a $20 toupee from Amazon or even a $5 toupee from AliExpress, it's obvious how unrealistic these cheap hairpieces are. The higher-end toupees in the $200 to $800 range stand up better to the eye test, but the effort needed to size, fit, glue, style, and maintain just seem troublesome and illogical. Toupees have to be regularly maintained as the glue sticking it to your scalp will wear off over time. At least once a month, you have to shave your scalp, apply new glue, spray special products to reduce odors, and reapply the entire toupee to keep hygiene and maintain the illusion. While there are salons who can do this for you for the price of a high-end haircut, these maintenance costs add up quickly. Conceptually, a toupee is only valuable if it's convincing to others. It's a temporary solution and half measure that disguises your baldness to the people around you, but it doesn't actually change the reality that you're balding. And at some point, whether it's once a night or once a month, I still have to take the toupee off. Ultimately, I would rather be balding out in the open than to constantly worry about maintaining a perfect illusion or being caught wearing fake hair. My goal is to find a permanent and sustainable solution to my baldness, not illusions. The next treatment I explored was medication. There are only two proven drugs for hair loss, finasteride and minoxidil. Finasteride is a tablet that you take every day to slow down hair loss. In its simplest abstraction, there's an enzyme in your body that converts testosterone into DHT. DHT is the hormone that directly causes hair loss. Finasteride blocks the actions of that enzyme, which then lowers your body's production of DHT, and then significantly slows down the rate at which you lose hair. Fundamentally, finasteride is a preventative measure. It slows baldness, but it doesn't stop it entirely. It also doesn't restore hair that's already been lost. Finasteride was invented by the American pharmaceutical giant Merck in 1993, and to this day is the most clinically effective drug against male pattern baldness. Finasteride is just one of many blockbuster drugs in Merck's portfolio. In 2020, Merck boasted six drugs that each surpassed over $1 billion in annual sales, the top four being Keytruda, a cancer treatment with sales of $14.3 billion, the second was Januvia, a medicine for type 2 diabetes with $5.3 billion, the third was an HPV vaccine with $3.9 billion, and the fourth was a chickenpox vaccine with $1.9 billion in sales. These days, finasteride is a widely available generic prescription as Merck's patent on the drug expired back in 2013. But in the 20 years from 1994 to 2013, when Merck's patent was valid, the company held a complete monopoly over hair loss medication. While Merck didn't break out product sales by medication until 2006, we can see that finasteride sales were healthy, contributing nearly $500 million every year. Keep in mind that you have to take finasteride every day for as long as you don't want to go bald. While you can always lower the dosage or frequency, people on finasteride are generally on it for life. It's remarkable that this single drug, with almost $500 million in annual sales, accounted for no more than 2% of Merck's annual revenue over its 20 years of exclusivity. It's a demonstration of how dominant Merck's pharmaceutical portfolio is, in that not even finasteride, at the height of its monopoly, was ever one of the company's top five best-selling drugs. One theory I have as to why finasteride didn't sell as much for Merck has to do with the US healthcare system. American health insurance companies like Aetna, Cigna, and Anthem Don't consider alopecia, hair loss, or male pattern baldness as a medical condition. As a result, consumers have to bear the entire cost of any medication or treatment for balding themselves. During Merck's monopoly in the mid-2000s, a 30-day supply of finasteride cost at least $90. Nowadays, a 90-day supply of finasteride costs me less than $30. The second reason for finasteride's commercial underperformance, again relative to other drugs in Merck's portfolio, has to do with its troubling side effects and dark history. With lower testosterone in your body, finasteride introduces potential side effects like decreased libido, erectile dysfunction, impotence, and male infertility. While Merck insists that finasteride is totally safe and that these side effects only ever appeared in less than 4% of patients, the reality is that even 1% chance of decreased libido and impotence is still 1% too high for many men. This potential gamble on your masculinity for the sake of appearance is why finasteride remains so controversial. There's no shortage of horror stories from men who experienced the side effects and had difficulty shaking them off even after stopping the medication. There's also many success stories from men on finasteride who downplay the side effects and insist that the bad experiences are exaggerations, fear-mongering, or placebo. In 2016, hundreds of men who took finasteride filed lawsuits against Merck, alleging that the pharmaceutical giant knowingly hid these side effects to keep sales up. They accused Merck of bringing an unsafe drug to market and manipulating the trial data to downplay the risks. Merck ended up settling most of these lawsuits out of court with hush money payments of $5,000 to $10,000 while successfully sealing away all the clinical data, dispositions, and confidential information away from public records. This was a win for Merck and another timeless demonstration of the immoral behavior, shady cover-ups, and the pay-your-way-out-of-trouble corporate capitalism that big pharmaceutical companies thrive in. These days, there are less than 25 lawsuits still pending against Merck. The individuals and families behind these lawsuits have organized themselves into the Post-Finasteride Syndrome Foundation, a nonprofit dedicated to exposing all the internal secrets that Merck has buried over the years about the drug. Given that Merck spends at least $10 million every year on lobbying, which, by the way, is only the amount that we can find in public records, and the American healthcare system doesn't recognize balding as a real medical condition, it's no surprise that these lawsuits have been stuck in limbo for years and remain low on the list of FDA priorities. When I pressed my dermatologist on the risks of finasteride, she unsurprisingly downplayed the side effects, claiming that none of her patients had ever experienced any. In the same breath, she tried to sell me non-FDA-approved natural herbal supplements that she claimed were just as effective as finasteride. Putting aside my dermatologist's shilling, her questionable morals, and Merck's unethical behavior, I eventually took the plunge on finasteride after being on the fence for weeks. Elon Musk, Gordon Ramsay, and the many other celebrities who went from bald domes to full heads of hair are all on finasteride. If these billionaires couldn't figure out a better, safer, anti-balding medication for themselves, then at least I can take some comfort knowing that this is the best boat available today and that we're all riding in it together. My experience 4 months in on finasteride has been a net positive. My hair loss has significantly slowed. Before finasteride, anytime I ran my fingers through my hair, my palms would be covered with clumps of hair falling out. On finasteride, this same motion only removes a few individual strands of my hair at most. As for side effects, there's no change in my libido, nor have I experienced anything close to impotence. But it does take more conscious effort for me to get in the mood in the bedroom. As an unexpected positive, I actually no longer wake up with the same aggressive energy or raging masculine temper that I used to have in my mid-20s. Perhaps this is placebo, but I'm tempted to chalk it up to the lower testosterone in my system. While the first few days on finasteride were a little nerve-wracking, I've gotten more comfortable with it over time. Like many others, I've experimented with reducing doses to find the right balance for myself between hair loss prevention and lower testosterone. The other anti-balding drug is minoxidil, or more commonly known as Rogaine. It's a medication that you apply to your scalp every day through foam and ointment in order to stimulate hair growth. However, minoxidil's effectiveness is modest at best. Since minoxidil is a local treatment for your scalp, it doesn't target the hormones in your body that directly cause hair loss the same way that finasteride does. While some men opt for both finasteride and minoxidil as a comprehensive solution to hair loss, I personally have only stuck to finasteride. My perspective is that it's easier to maintain hair than it is to regrow it. Finasteride is a guaranteed preventative measure, while minoxidil is an inconclusive reactive measure where hair regrowth itself is not guaranteed, it takes months to see results, and is yet another drug where as soon as you stop taking it, everything goes away. Having already signed onto one lifelong drug with finasteride, I've been hesitant to add another to the list. Surgery is a last treatment option and is widely considered to be the most effective, long-lasting, yet invasive and expensive solution for male pattern baldness. Hair transplants are by definition invasive surgeries, meaning there's a puncturing of skin, open wounds, and a recovery period involved. With finasteride and minoxidil, progress is noticeable only after months of continuous use, and it comes with its aforementioned risks. In comparison, a one-time 4 to 10 hour hair transplant in exchange for a clearly defined, visible, immediate, and improved end state is a great ROI compared to prosthesis or medication. As someone in their late 20s, I wanted to tackle my male pattern baldness as early as possible and had plenty of healthy hairs at the back of my head to donate for a transplant. Hair transplants are simple procedures. A surgeon relocates healthy hair from the areas of your head where you have lots of it, typically the back or the sides of your head, to the areas where you don't have hair. It takes 9 to 12 months for the newly planted hair follicles to grow fully, and not every hair that's transplanted over will survive the journey. A hair transplant in its simplest form is a permanent rearrangement of the hair on your head. There are two types of hair transplants, FUE and FUT. The only difference between these two is how the hair is extracted and harvested from the donor area. FUT stands for follicular unit transportation. The surgeon cuts out an entire piece of your scalp, closes the incision with stitches, and then separates that piece of scalp into smaller pieces called grafts. Grafts contain 1 to 4 hairs, their follicles, along with the surrounding skin tissue that provides the nourishment for those hairs to grow. The surgeon will then make small holes in your bald recipient areas and insert the grafts one at a time. FUT is the most traditional form of hair transplant and can take 10 to 20 hours depending on the number of grafts. A single hair transplant can involve anywhere from 600 to 5,000 grafts depending on the health of the donor area, the severity of the hair loss, and the size of the recipient areas. FUT results in slightly higher yield, but is overall more invasive, requires a longer recovery period, and leaves permanent scarring. FUE, the other type of hair transplant, stands for follicular unit extraction. Instead of cutting out and transporting a piece of your scalp, a surgeon meticulously extracts hair follicles one at a time from your donor area. The harvested grafts are then planted one by one into the recipient areas. FUE is the more popular form of hair transplant as it's easier, less invasive, faster, and then more affordable. FUE surgeries can be completed in 4 to 8 hours with no scars or stitches involved. While I personally never wanted to take finasteride, the drug is required for successful, long-lasting hair transplants. A hair transplant restores hair in bald areas, but it doesn't do anything for your existing hair. If you got a hair transplant, but you didn't slow down your hair loss through finasteride, you would end up with a tale of two heads. In the front, you would have healthy hair growing out, but in the back, you would be balding, shedding, and losing hair, so you would see Moses parting the seas on your scalp. Getting a hair transplant in the West is expensive. Reputable clinics in the United States and Canada can cost anywhere from $10,000 to $25,000 for a single hair transplant. While one has the freedom to stop and start medication whenever they want, hair transplants are generally one-and-done surgeries. There's a finite amount of hairs that can be harvested, and the hairs that are extracted from the donor areas will never grow back. While the surgical methods and tools are consistent around the world, hair transplants are more art than science. It takes skill and experience to transplant hairs in a natural manner and construct new hairlines that align with one's forehead, facial features, and face shape. How the new hairs are specifically arranged is critical to the final result. A bad hair transplant can lead to infections, inconsistent growth, and unconvincing appearances. As the less invasive and more cost-efficient procedure, I settled on FUE for my hair transplant and began looking overseas. Shelling out $10,000 to $25,000 upfront for a hair transplant in the United States was out of my budget. Because of how cost-prohibitive these hair transplants are in the West, I had a lot of open concerns on how much these doctors really had when they only perform a handful of surgeries every month. Turkey, Mexico, and Spain came up as popular medical tourism destinations for hair transplants that cost only $2,000 to $5,000. Many clinics in these countries advertise their all-in-one packages where they take care of not only the surgery, but also the hotel, itinerary, transportation, translation, and even drop you off back to your flight to the US 24 hours after the surgery. While these package deals are convenient, what I was really after was a highly skilled surgeon with a great track record and whose customers were local and not Americans and foreigners looking to save a quick buck. South Korea is the cosmetic surgery capital of the world. In this land of K-pop, K-dramas, and Parasite, cosmetic surgery is a way of life. The country performs over 1 million cosmetic surgeries every year and has the highest per capita rate of cosmetic surgery in the world, with 14 out of every 1,000 Koreans going under the knife every year. The beauty ideals and standards in Korea are so high that it's normal for celebrities, singers, and other public icons to undergo multiple surgeries as early as their teenage years. A friend of mine who grew up in Korea offered me the name of several clinics that many locals considered to be the best in the country. One of them was Dr. Kim Kyung-bok of Moment Clinic, a celebrated surgeon who rose to local prominence after having performed successful hair transplant for celebrities. Dr. Kim was so popular that there was a waiting list for his new clinic in Gangnam. Gangnam is the wealthiest neighborhood in South Korea and known as the Beverly Hills of the country, with the highest concentration of cosmetic surgery clinics in its 15-mile borders. Dr. Kim and his Moment Clinic are so oriented for local Koreans that they don't actually have any English-speaking staff on hand. For every conversation I had with his clinic over KakaoTalk, which is Korea's equivalent of Facebook Messenger, I had to use Google Translate. While I went through multiple virtual consultations with different clinics and doctors in Korea, it was Dr. Kim's professionalism, detail, his local popularity, and his body of work that sealed the deal for me. I flew out to Korea in mid-July for my hair transplant with Dr. Kim. As a first-time visitor to South Korea, I was blown away with the maturity and government sponsorship behind the country's medical tourism. When you land at Incheon Airport and walk towards arrivals, the largest booth at the center of the lobby is not a generic information desk, but rather a huge medical tourism support center. There's staff on hand who can speak English, Chinese, Japanese, Vietnamese, French, German, and they're all hired by the Korean government to facilitate medical tourists like me. Walking through the streets of Gangnam to Moment Clinic on the day of my surgery was equally eye-opening. In just 4 blocks from the subway station, I had passed nearly 20 different plastic surgery clinics, doctor offices, and pharmacies, each with signs in Korean promoting their services and success stories to locals. Located on the 6th floor, Moment Clinic was a clean, modern, new, and sophisticated office. And as I had expected, Dr. Kim was a gracious, soft-spoken, and kind man. While he spoke very little English, he made every effort to communicate his approach, detail, and vision, using a pen to draw out my new proposed hairline and the exact areas he felt would be most effective. Looking back, as a very nervous American in a foreign country, I'm most grateful for Dr. Kim's empathy, as he would regularly pause to listen and hear my feedback through the translator. At one point, he even redrew the lines during consultation after I shared some suggestions and perspective. Surgery started right after the consultation. As they put in the IV, I was a pretty anxious mess, shaking on the operating table. I'd never done any surgery like this before, and hair transplants rely on local anesthesia, so I was awake and conscious the entire time. The surgery was an exercise of patience, lying down without moving for roughly 6 hours while he and his staff of 5 nurses operated on me. Even though Dr. Kim didn't see many foreigners, he made a lot of small gestures, like intentionally playing an American radio station during the surgery so I would feel comfortable. What amazes me to this day was the staff discipline during my 6 hours of surgery. Beyond one or two words here or there, there was no chatter or gossip, just 6 hours of silent concentration, music, and surgical noises. The whole time my face was covered with an eye mask and bandages, so at no point did I see or feel anything. Extraction of my hairs took about 3.5 hours, and then planting the hairs took another 2.5 hours. For around 4,300 grafts, my total cost for this hair transplant with Dr. Kim came to $5,500, which was payable with Visa. Looking back at my progress to date through these months, while my new hair won't fully grow out for another 3 to 6 months, I've been overjoyed with the early results. My hair transplant with Dr. Kim and Moment Clinic has actually been a genuinely wonderful and life-changing experience. I would rate wisdom teeth removal as a much more painful procedure in my book than a hair transplant. My plan is actually to go back to revisit Dr. Kim after a year for a touch-up to further lower my hairline once the hair follicles in my donor area fully heal. In full transparency, I wasn't compensated or given any discount to talk about Dr. Kim and Moment Clinic. The price that I paid for my hair transplant was the same price that everyone else pays, local or foreign. For most men, hair transplants are a question of who rather than how, and finding a trustworthy clinic overseas is no easy task. For me, I was extremely fortunate to have a Korean friend whose recommendations I trusted deeply and could help me cut through all the tourist traps and shady doctors. For those that are interested, I've included a contact email for Dr. Kim Kyung-bok and Moment Clinic in the description, along with their YouTube channel and website if anyone's interested. You can follow the same process I did. Reach out over email, include some photos of your situation, and they'll provide you with a proposal, quote, and availability. Like me, you would need to organize your own accommodations, translator, and travel, but those are small and manageable costs in the grand scheme of things. Researching this episode and experiencing the business of balding brought me around the world and back, from dermatologist office in the United States, to pharmacies, and then eventually to South Korea. Feeling and having hair in areas where I used to be bald is a magical feeling that's hard to put into words. And for once, I actually look like someone in their mid to late 20s, and for that, I'm thankful.